who are the inspiration for any person, especially in the field of meteorology and atmospheric science research. First, I would like to invite Air Vice Marshal Professor Dr. Ajit Tyagi, Chairman and one of the backbones of our newly formed association. I welcome Professor Tyagi sir for introductory remarks on SAMA, that is South Asian Meteorological Association, to narrate the vision and mission. Tyagi sir.
Good afternoon and thank you, Swagat sir. It's a matter of great honor to welcome all the participants on behalf of newly formed South Asian Meteorological Association, SAMA. It's a professional, not-for-profit association for the promotion of meteorology and allied sciences in the South Asian countries for the socio-economic development and disaster risk reduction. South Asian countries bounded by the ocean to the south and Himalayas in the north share common climate, and the vagaries of the monsoon, the extreme weather events like floods, drought, extreme temperatures, poor air quality is experienced by all the countries. We at SAMA want to provide an open platform for the meteorological community, academic and research institutions, NGOs and general public to participate and promote the meteorology in the region with no borders limiting our interactions and promotion. The objective of, broadly objective of the society is to promote interaction among the meteorologists and the allied scientists and the people working in the application field, advancement of the meteorology as a profession and the application for the benefit of the society and the disaster risk reduction and sustainable development. We are happy that all the nine South Asian countries are actively participating, and we have esteemed members from these countries on our advisory committee. And we also have a very dynamic executive support team of the young professionals who are spearheading the growth of this meteorology. In the last 2 months, we have been able to do a good amount of foundation work, of which the Ozone Day celebrations, MET quiz, and other activities are taking place now, and we have got many more in the pipeline. Once again, let me extend welcome to all the participants and request them to join this initiative to promote meteorology in the region for the benefit of the society. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, your kind note, and it's a great inspiration for all of us. Now, I also share that our online quiz was organized by SAMA, India Meteorological Department, Vigyan Prasar, and Indian Meteorological Society for this Ozone Day celebrations. We have received enormous responses, and there are more than 20,000 participants from all the other nine countries. So now I come to the topic, the ozone. Earth without ozone is like a house without a roof. It is our turn to lead, wishing you a very happy World Ozone Day. On this occasion, Dr. Bijoy Kumar Soni will talk about the 35 years of ozone layer protection, a scientific perspective. Just a little housekeeping before we get started. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into the chat box in YouTube. I'll bring them up at the end of the talk and during the panel discussion. Now, without any further ado, I would like to invite our today's speaker, Dr. Bijoy Kumar Soni. Dr. Soni obtained his MSc Physics from IIT Roorkee and PhD in Atmospheric Sciences from University of Pune. He joined the Indian Meteorological Department in 1999 as a meteorologist. At present, he is working as head Environmental Monitoring and Research Center, IMD, New Delhi. He is also head Polar Meteorological Research Division of IMD. He contributed significantly to establish the aerosol and black carbon monitoring network in India called Skynet India. Dr. Soni has contributed immensely in setting up a modern meteorological observatory at Bharti Station in Antarctica. So we found the right person to talk about the ozone hole today. Dr. Soni also has been prolific in his scientific efforts, publishing more than 50 research papers in peer-reviewed journals, along with few meteorological monographs on various topics and few chapters in books. His recent research work on global dimming and brightening has received wide appreciation. His research interests, including aerosols, solar radiation, air quality, and polar meteorology. Dr. Soni was also awarded a Certificate of Merit by the Ministry of Earth Sciences for his outstanding contribution in the field of atmospheric science. Dr. Soni, sir, so now you can proceed with your...
Thank you. Thank you, Swagat, for this nice introduction. And at the very outset, I would thank Sama, MS, AMD, and Vigyan Prasad for giving this opportunity to speak on ozone layer. And it's a great privilege to speak before the persons whom I really admire most, Dr. Tyagi, Dr. Rathod, and many senior officers. So, you are able to see this screen now?
Yes, sir. Fine. So he may be go to the full screen. Yeah.
So, I'll be speaking on this 35 years of ozone layer protection. And you see these four posters, beautiful posters released by United Nations of kids. And the message is that the environment, if not better, that we are enjoying right now, that we should leave for our children. So my talk will have at least something for everybody. So not very complex science, and I tried to make it as popular as possible. So I'll be speaking about ozone, what why ozone is a concern, trends in ozone hole, and the Vienna Convention, Montreal Protocol, and what we can do. So ozone is basically an allotrope of oxygen. So three oxygen atoms makes this ozone. And ozone is present in all throughout the atmosphere in very trace quantity, much less as compared to the nitrogen, oxygen, or carbon dioxide. But it plays two important roles here. So in troposphere, it is a pollutant, and in upper atmosphere, it's good for human being. And little bit chemistry, how this surface ozone is formed. So basically, ozone is a secondary pollutant. It is not emitted directly from any source. So it is formed with the reaction of nitrogen dioxide with the ultraviolet radiation. And the concentration is determined by the ratio of NO2 and NO in the atmosphere. There are other many precursors of surface ozone, like carbon monoxide, hydrocarbons, volatile organic carbons. So I'll not deeply go into the chemistry of formation of surface ozone. The why actually surface ozone is a concern. So it's a major pollutant, and it is a greenhouse gas. It is very important greenhouse gas. You can see that radiative forcing of surface ozone, tropospheric ozone, is comparable to the methane. So it is really a potential pollutant as well as the greenhouse gas. And it is a very difficult greenhouse gas because of the variation in time and space. So highly variable in space and time. So you see here, this is a healthy lung, and the below one is the lung inflamed by the ozone. So ozone basically affects the lungs of human being. And now during the pandemic days, the corona also affects the lungs. So all the people should take care that the pollution can also aggravate such type of disease. And the lungs of children are not that mature, and the old people do not have that strong lungs. So most vulnerable population is the children and the elderly people. So they should take care, particularly during this pandemic time. So now I'll explain how it is distributed in the atmosphere. So in left side is this how we are measuring the ozone. So the ozone is divided into two layers: a surface ozone, upper tropospheric ozone, and the stratospheric ozone. So the only way to measure the atmospheric ozone is through the balloon. So we attach a sensor with the balloon, and it goes up and keeps measuring the ozone concentration in the atmosphere. So around 20-25 kilometer, this peak ozone layer is detected. That is in the stratosphere, and of course it varies with the latitude. So this balloon goes in the up to 40 kilometers and keeps measuring the ozone concentration. So this is when it reaches around 40 kilometer, then it blows like anything, and you can see that this balloon reaches up to a size of truck in the upper stratosphere. And when it is falling, the instrument falls with the parachute. So when it is moving up, then also it is measuring the ozone, and when it is falling, then also it is measuring the ozone. So this is how the ozone concentration is measured in the atmosphere. So in Delhi, we have this facility. So any generally through Indian Meteorological Society, or through or if any school or anybody requests to visit this event, they can always welcome to contact us, and we'll arrange their visit through IMS or through IMD or through SAMA. So generally, this total columnar ozone is from surface to top of the atmosphere in a column, how much ozone is there. So that is that we call the total columnar ozone. And the unit of measurement is the Dobson unit. This is given after the scientist GMB Dobson, who studied the ozone and developed an instrument called Dobson spectrophotometer. So if you compress all the ozone in the atmosphere from top of the atmosphere to surface at 0 degree centigrade and 1 atmospheric pressure, then the total ozone will form a 3 mm thick thickness of ozone. And 3 mm thickness is equal to the 300 Dobson unit. So 1 mm thickness is actually 100 Dobson unit. And these are the instruments here. So This is the left one is the Dobson spectrophotometer, and it was developed in 1920s by Dobson, and in 1927 with the word ozone measurement, this first Dobson was brought to India, and the measurements were made at Kodaikanal. And India Meteorological Department acquired its first Dobson in 1950. And you'll be surprised that for last 7 decades, we have measurements of total columnar ozone with the Dobson spectrophotometer. So still it is considered as a reference instrument. And on right side, this is another instrument called Brewer spectrophotometer. This is a little advanced instrument. It can keep tracking the sun automatically, but Dobson spectrometer manually you have to adjust. But Dobson is still preferred by the World Meteorological Organization. And we right now we have 2 Dobson spectrophotometer recently calibrated by WMO at Germany. And so periodically we calibrate this instrument. So this is the standard instrument for measurement of total columnar ozone. So we have all the 3 types of measurement available with us. One is the total columnar ozone, and then we'll release the balloon for measuring the profile, and the surface ozone photometers. And there are many satellites measuring the ozone in the atmosphere. So there are a number of satellites, OMI, ozone monitoring instrument, or ORA, that is very popular instrument. And the Indian satellite INSAT-3D and INSAT-3D-R also can measure the ozone. So this on right side, these are the graphs. These are the pictures of INSAT-3D total columnar ozone. So ozone generally lower in near the equator, and as we move towards higher latitude, the total columnar ozone increases. So INSAT-3D can very well capture this ozone variation. And there are several reanalysis data and chemical model data, MERA 2, GOSFP, and NASA, GMAO. So the formation of ozone in stratosphere is very simple. The oxygen atom absorb ultraviolet radiation in the stratosphere and breaks up into the atomic oxygen. Atomic oxygen reacts with the oxygen and forms the ozone. So this is a very simple reaction in the as far as ozone formation is concerned. So how this ozone layer forms around 20-25 kilometers. So basically the ozone is created when oxygen is there in the stratosphere and the ultraviolet radiation is there. So the 2 ingredients for stratospheric ozone production are the oxygen as well as the ultraviolet sunlight. So on top side of what layer, the production is limited because availability of molecular oxygen is limited, which drops off exponentially. The ultraviolet radiation when it reaches, so bottom side it is again limited because it is getting absorbed by the oxygen. So there is a layer that forms around 20 to 30 kilometer, between 20 and 30 kilometer. That we call the ozone layer. And the importance is that it protects a human being from the ultraviolet radiation. So ultraviolet C is very harmful. So almost all ultraviolet C is absorbed by the ozone layer. and almost 90% of ozone UV B is absorbed by the ozone layer, and UV A is able to penetrate in the atmosphere, able to reach the surface. And the, similarly, the ozone destruction takes place in the stratosphere. The ozone absorbs the ultraviolet radiation and breaks into oxygen and ozone, oxygen and oxygen molecule and oxygen atom. So there is a formation of ozone and destruction of ozone. So when there is equilibrium, there is not a problem actually. But when this equilibrium breaks, then there is really a problem of destruction of ozone, destruction of ozone hole or formation of ozone hole. So this problem arises when there is chlorofluorocarbon or freons or such elements are there in the atmosphere. So briefly, I'll define what actually ozone hole. So it's not actually the hole, but ozone depleted in the stratosphere. So there is no physical kind of hole, but a significant reduction in the ozone in stratosphere that we call the ozone. And any area that where this total column ozone becomes less than 220 Dobson unit, we call it the ozone hole. So such is the variation in the atmosphere of ozone. And this is the average profile. So in September, we have this red one and very distinct ozone layer present. And as the season advances, this keeps decreasing. And in particularly late September and October, this at times are there when it is completely depleted. So most of the time 50%, and there are certain cases when more than 90% of this ozone in stratosphere is depleted. And these are the three observers working in the British Antarctic Survey station, HALEY. And they were making measurements right from 1970s, 76 onwards. And they were observing that the total columnar ozone is getting decreased in September, October. But they did not believe it. That they thought that there may be a malfunction, instrument is malfunctioning. But when they found that this trend is continuing for several years, and they also compared their results with the nearby station, then they thought that it's a natural variation in the stratospheric ozone. And then in 1985, they published these results in Nature. And 1985, we say that ozone hole was discovered. So this cross is basically from the British Antarctic observations, and these triangles are the NASA satellite measurements. And this graph, that increasing, is basically the concentration of freons. So it was before this discovery of ozone hole, it was confirmed that chlorofluorocarbons are responsible for destruction of the ozone. So there are five major ingredients that really destroy the ozone layer: the chlorine from CFCs, the cold temperature, Antarctic polar vortex, the seasons, the dark and light season, and clouds. I'll explain in coming slides quickly, and the UV radiation. So when winter is there, there is no sun, and the whole polar region gets very cold. And the air that moves from tropics to the polar towards pole in stratosphere through Dobson-Brewer circulation, they start turning over the poles because of the Coriolis force and make a vortex. So in this vortex, is millions of square kilometer in size. And the ozone, as well as the CFCs and many other pollutants, get trapped in the polar vortex. So this happens during the winter. But when sun appears in September, then this is in Antarctica, and the similar kind of vortex forms in the Arctic also. Arctic is not that polar vortex is not that strong as compared to the Antarctic because of the temperature difference. Temperature of Arctic is much higher as compared to the Antarctic. So this is how this polar vortex forms. And within this polar vortex, this polar stratospheric clouds are formed. So on the right side, you are seeing these beautiful pictures are basically the polar stratospheric clouds. This is not the handmade painting, but actual picture of polar stratospheric clouds. And these clouds are formed of nitric acid, sulfuric acid mixtures. And they provide a surface where this chlorofluorocarbon can break into the chlorine. The chlorine can be released in the stratosphere. So when this ultraviolet radiation, when sun appears in September and falls on the chlorofluorocarbon, then this chlorine is released from the CFCs. And this one chlorine can destroy thousands of ozone molecules. So this is a potential, this is how this chlorine destroys the ozone in the stratosphere. And this ozone is not destroyed. This CFC is not, chlorine is not completely destroyed in the stratosphere, but keeps on destroying the ozone. So one chlorine atom has potential to destroy thousands of molecules of ozone. And you see, this is the this is how the ozone hole progresses. In March, April, actually in southern hemisphere, the winter starts in March, April, May, June, July, like that. It is opposite to that of in northern hemisphere. So the sun starts disappearing in March, temperature starts cooling, and around June, July, this temperature reaches minus 80 degrees centigrade. So when temperature reaches below minus 78 degrees centigrade, then this polar stratospheric clouds start forming. And when the sun appears in September, then the ultraviolet radiation with the reaction with the CFCs start destroying the ozone in the atmosphere. So we start experiencing the ozone. But as sun appears, then the temperature starts rising, and then polar vortex breaks up. So in November, December, somewhere around December or sometimes in November, this polar vortex completely breaks up, and the ozone hole again fills up with the fresh air, bringing the ozone towards pole. now. Yeah, so this is the time series that is measured with the help of satellites. 1985, when this was discovered, then the average area was about 14.2 million square kilometer, and during 2019, the area was 9.3 million square kilometer. So the 2019 was unusual year when this average ozone hole area was the lowest after discovery of the ozone hole. And the below graph is the average minimum columnar ozone. That is generally the columnar ozone is taken, average is taken from 21st September to 16 October when ozone hole is prominent. So we see that this ozone hole area is a little bit, there is a trend and this is changing. So 2019, there was no instance, no when this decline, significant decline of total columnar ozone was there. Unlike in the other years, you can see from this figure. And this is the ozone hole right now. So this is the time when ozone hole is appearing. So already on September 12, the ozone hole area was 23 million square kilometer. And on August 22nd, it reached the total columnar ozone reached 141 Dobson unit. And right now it is approximately 157 Dobson unit. So already this ozone hole area is there. So last year this ozone hole area was the minimum, but we see that this year it may not be so. So the red one is the ozone hole area that is increasing, and it is already more than the 2019 and 2018 ozone hole area, compared with the ozone hole area. So there are seasonal variation, and these seasonal variation are depending on the meteorology of the region. Now I'll come to the how this ozone hole or ozone layer is behaving. So in 1985, this Vienna Convention came into existence for the protection of ozone layer. But it was a voluntary measure. So it was basically a convention. But when convention become legally binding, then we start calling it the protocol. So the Montreal Protocol is the result of the Vienna Convention. And this Montreal Protocol is signed by all the countries of United Nations, all 197 countries of the United Nations. And this is considered the one of the very successful multilateral agreement, environmental agreement in the history that has brought the positive results. So under this Montreal Protocol, CFCs were banned, and there were a gradual phase out of CFCs. CFCs were replaced with the HCFCs because available that time. HCFCs are less damaging to the, still damaging to the ozone layer, but comparative to CFCs, these HCFCs are less damaging. And then HCFCs have been replaced with the HFCs, hydrofluorocarbons. So hydrofluorocarbons have zero ozone depleting potential. But again, this HFCs are controlled under the Kyoto Protocol. So now we have to phase out this HFCs also. So under the Kigali amendment, that this Kigali meeting happened in on October 15th in 2018, and all 197 countries have signed this this particular amendment to the Montreal Protocol, and they have committed that HFCs will be phased out in next 30 years, and there are a substitute available for HFCs, the propane, isobutane, NOR-441A, ammonia, carbon dioxide. So these are the replacement for the HFC. So hopefully this Kigali amendment will bring this particular change in HFC. And with the Montreal Protocol, with existence of Montreal Protocol, now you see that this graph is enough here. So all the CFCs are showing a declining trend, because CFCs were replaced with the HCFCs. So HCFCs are showing increasing trend. But see the first graph. This is the equivalent effective stratospheric chlorine, and it is showing a significant decline. And projection is that this will keep on decreasing. So as a result of this decline in chlorine, then we have a very positive hope that by 2065, this ozone hole will be disappear. So next slide, you'll be, so sure. With Montreal,
three four minutes more. Okay.
So with Montreal Protocol, you can see the ozone hole will not appear, but without Montreal Protocol, there is a scaring situation here on the right side. You can see. So without Montreal Protocol, whole globe would have experienced a significant ozone loss. So it is not, it would have not limited to the poles only, but all over the globe, and this would have been there. So this is the word avoided. This figure is from the paper by Paul Newman, appeared in ACB. Word avoided means say as it is, the business as usual. So by 2065, we would have reached less than 100 Dobson unit in the atmosphere. So this is the second one. This figure is for the polar region in southern hemisphere, Antarctica. And we found that this ozone hole, total ozone is showing an increasing trend. So this is a positive sign. And in other part of the world also, this slight increasing trend of total ozone is observed. So this is the summary basically, and it gives really a good hope to us that there is a clear sign so far that ozone increases over the last 20 years in the upper stratosphere, and a decrease in severity of Antarctic ozone hole in the September. And it is certain that significant ozone decline from 1960 to 1990s has almost leveled off. And the worldwide ban on ozone depleting substances by Montreal Protocol and its amendment has been really successful. So as I told earlier, that this is a very successful protocol in the history. Sorry, this presentation is still heavy, so it is, yeah. So I should not forget to mention that India is having that two stations in Antarctica. One is the Bharti. This was established in 2012, and the Maitri was established in 1983. But the Indian expedition started in 1981. So we keep we have the meteorological observations from these stations as well as the ozone observations in the at these stations. But our stations are basically the coastal stations. So these are the observations from our station. So this ozone hole keeps coming in and out at these stations. And the consequences of the ozone layer depletion, increased ultraviolet radiation, then there are biological effects, increased tropospheric ozone because there are stratospheric tropospheric exchange of ozone, and the increased production of the vitamin D, effect on animals, effect on crop. So it affects the vegetation significantly. And just a brief, what we should do actually, what citizens can do. Basically one thing is that when there is during the summer, when there is a lot of ultraviolet radiation, then one must take precautions to use umbrella or sunscreen and use the sunglasses, because the incidence of cataract are increasing because of the increase in ultraviolet radiation. And the best way to assess the maximum ultraviolet radiation is see your shadow. So when the shadow is very small, then you have maximum exposure of ultraviolet radiation or solar radiation. So I am almost done, and take care of your appliances, mainly the air condition and refrigerators. Use CFCs, HCFCs, and this ozone depleting substances. So keep your appliances perfect condition. And when you are switching over to the new appliance, please take care that these are handed over for proper recycling, because this compressor contains the ozone depleting substances. So thank you very much for listening to me, and if you have any questions, I really will be able to And also, if you are not able to put up the question right now, then you can email me these questions, and I will be very happy to respond.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. It's a wonderful talk. It's showing the in-depth study of ozone, and I am sure it would be a very beneficial for the society. So now it's a time to invite our two distinguished scientists. One is Dr. Samarendra Karmakar from Bangladesh and Dr. Madanlal Shrestha from Nepal. They are also the member of advisory committee of SAMA. Dr. Samarendra Karmakar, Dr. Samarendra Karmakar is currently the chairman of National Oceanography and Maritime Institute and deputy team leader MSSI of World Bank Project, Bangladesh. He has done his MSc from Dhaka University, MS from University of the Philippines, and doctorate from Khulna University of Engineering and Technology. He joined Bangladesh Meteorological Department in 1977 and retired as director of Bangladesh Meteorological Department also he shark he took care of the Shark Meteorological Research Center in 2006. He received 5th and 14th Shark Young Scientist Award in meteorology for his research contribution. In addition, Dr. Karmakar joined in SMRC as the head of synoptic division in September 1996 for 3 years. And our other panelist is Dr. Madan Lal Shrestha. He is an academician at Nepal Academy of Science and Technology with a PhD degree in meteorology from University of Hawaii. He served as the Director General of the Department of Hydrology and Meteorology, Nepal, and has been the permanent representative of Nepal to the World Meteorological Organization. He was the scientist and division head of the Shark Meteorological Research Center. He has been the focal point. He has been the focal point of Nepal to IPCC and contributed to the working group 2 of the third assessment report of IPCC in producing the publication Climate Change 2001, Impact, Adaptation and Vulnerability. He is also the scientific planning group member of Asia Pacific Network for Global Change Research, representing Nepal. He has published many research papers in peer-reviewed journals and also the member of few famous scientific journals. So now I will go to the question answer. So welcome Dr. Samanendra Karmakar and Dr. Madan Lal Shrestha. So camera can show them.
Thank you, Dr. Swagat.
Yeah, so I have few questions, but before going to the detailed question, scientific question, I have one question to Dr. Madan Lal Shrestha. How the state of ozone layer relates with the global warming and society?
First of all, I think I would like to thank Dr. Soni for his very illustrative presentations. I think everybody will really gain good knowledge from his presentations. I think because of the time, so I think because this is the, when we talk about the climate change, we normally talk about the greenhouse gases, like carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, et cetera, in warming the Earth atmosphere system. But I think this ozone also plays a very, very important role. As Dr. Soni has mentioned, you know, two kind of ozone, one in the troposphere from the surface to about 10 kilometers, 12 kilometers. Another is above that, you know, up to 12 to 50 kilometers. And we say that the one near the Earth's surface is a bad ozone. And the one in the upper troposphere, stratosphere, is a good ozone, which protects us from sealing the, you know, harmful ultraviolet rays. And one thing I would like to mention that, you know, we are talking about the greenhouse gases, which has a direct impact in the warming process. But the ozone plays a very, this ozone, which we talk about the, you know, the passing of the ultraviolet rays from the sun to the earth depends on the ozone. If there is depletion of ozone, then the more of the ultraviolet ray reach the surface of the earth. And very interestingly, if we look at the ocean, and you know, if we look at this, the effect of this ultraviolet radiation, and this ozone layer depletion seems likely to increase the rate and scale of greenhouse warming by reducing the effectiveness of the carbon dioxide sink in the ocean, because ocean is the big reservoir of these greenhouse gases. And interestingly, you know, in the ocean, we have the phytoplanktons. That's a very tiny organism, And when they are exposed to even a small increase in the ultraviolet radiation, and their activity drops drastically. And because of this role of this ultraviolet rays in the phytoplankton, the Montreal Protocol's environmental effects panel has warned that any reduction in the carbon fixing activity by allowing a large amount of carbon dioxide to remain in the atmosphere, adding to the extent of the global warming. Because if the phytoplanktons are affected, then the absorption of the greenhouse gases by the ocean is very much reduced. That means more greenhouse gases will be there in the atmosphere. And that is, I think, the one thing that, actually those who are working in the climate change science, so they are worried. Because every 10% depletion of ozone layer, we can expect 20% increase in ultraviolet radiation arriving at the grounds. So I think these things affect the activity of the phytoplankton in this carbon processing. And so I think in that way, when the ocean does not work in absorbing the greenhouse gases, the more greenhouse gases will be there in the atmosphere, which I think the people are emitting. And that is the main reason that it will, aggravate the global warming that we already have by the man-made activities. So I think in that way, less uptaking by the ocean of the greenhouse gases will enhance the global warming. And so I think we will have more of this climate change. And, since I live in the, the Himalayan regions, so we know how this climate change is really affecting our ecosystem. Because as you know, I think most of the glaciers are retreating, and which is the main source of the freshwater reserve in the whole Asia and in the globe itself. So I think this ozone today that we are having, the ozone day, which is I think very, very crucial in giving the message that I think the depletion of this ozone is very, very crucial, or it will have a negative impact in the climate, in the climate change. So I think to protect the ozone layer is, I think, one of our duty for the safety of this humankind and the society. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. There are a lot of questions. So quickly, I ask a few questions to any of the panelists, mainly to the presenter, maybe. I got a question from even Dr. Ajit Tyagi, sir, and Dr. Sunita Verma, and the points are nearly same. Regions for interannual variability of ozone layer and minima observed in 2019. What is the recent trend of healing of ozone layer? So, Shoni sir, if you can enlighten something.
Yeah, 2019 was really an unusual year, and we call a phenomena that is the sudden stratospheric warming. So during 2019, it appeared. It's a very rare phenomena. Last time it happened in 2002, and now it happened in 2019. So the stratospheric temperature increased by almost 16 degrees centigrade this time. And because of that, this polar vortex broken down. Okay. And that led to the minima during 2019. And annual variability is mostly related to the meteorology in upper air. So the temperature and the circulation, sometimes weak, sometimes strong. So that because of that, this polar vortex is, or the jet around that polar vortex is sometimes strong or sometimes weak. So the inter-annual variability is because of that phenomenon.
Okay, sir. Now I will go to the Dr. Parmokar, sir, because it's a South Asian Meteorological Association. So, sir, what is the plan? May I propose atmospheric ozone and its scope of research in Bangladesh? Dr. Karmakar, sir. Hello? Dr. Karmakar, sir, are you there?
Dr. Shwagata ji, due to internet interruption, he is not available now. So, I think you can continue the question answer session and rest on. I think by this time, he joined, then you can continue. Thank you.
Okay.
Over.
Okay. So is there any satellite which we can measure the hourly ozone and UV index? Question asked by Dr. Divya Prakash.
Yeah, there are a lot of satellite, but there is no satellite which can give the hourly ozone values. Most of these satellites are polar satellites, so only once in a day you can get, like OMI on Aura and AIRS, this also once in a day you can get the observation. INSAT 3D is there, but INSAT 3D also 3 hourly observations can give during daytime.
And how many observation we have? Yeah, that exact question from Dr. Saurabh Sonawani. How many stations are available for the total columnar ozone measurements in India? Is there any possibility for researchers to obtain real-time data of total columnar ozone from IMD?
Yeah, total columnar ozone from IMD are available in public domain. So not only from India, you can get all the data from all over the world. So there is these our stations fall under the WMO program, and WMO has a World Ozone and UV Data Center, WOUDC. So you just to Google WOUDC, and you will have access of data from all the countries. So right now in India, we had actually 5 sites. But 2 sites are continuously giving that data. And there are many other institutions. Of course, you will have to contact the particular institutions which measure the total column ozone with the handheld sun photometer, or you can call them ozonometer. But they are individual stations. And NARL Gadanki is also having this measurement available. So these are the only source in India. But our data you can access through WOUDC.
Okay, sir. Yeah, it is in Canada, isn't it?
Sorry?
The center is in Canada.
Yes. Canada. Canada is hosting this.
Yeah, so one question we have, that how does the Antarctic ozone hole affect our South Asian countries? Is there any specific answer on it?
Yeah, ozone hole actually main depletion is over the polar right now. But the ozone, it was found that the total column ozone was decreasing all over at other latitudes also. Decrease was not only restricted over the polar region. But now we are finding that this over other latitudes also, this total columnar ozone is showing increasing trend in last 20 years.
So there are 2 questions. One of them is related to modeling, that how is performance of warp cam when integrated for the atmosphere to check the ozone condition in the ozone concentration in the atmosphere, or is it possible to forecast ozone concentration for a particular domain? Yeah, it's possible. Okay.
Yeah, it is possible. We are giving forecast for surface ozone we have this air quality early warning system for Delhi, and now we have expanded this forecasting system to all over the country. So anybody can log in that EWS.propmed.res.in, and you can see this forecast. So we have several models under that. So right now we are running 4 models. WRF CAM is one of them, CLEM and Enfuser, and one model for the dust. So you can have a look, and yes, it is very well possible to forecast the ozone concentration in the atmosphere, not only surface ozone but the total columnar ozone.
The last question to both the panelists: how is ozone expected to change with climate change? How is ozone expected to change with climate change? Any of the panelists, please. Shrestha sir, you are in mute.
Yeah, I think maybe Dr. Soni would be the best person, but in my view, I think the role of ozone, I have already said that it has some kind of effect in the biosphere and the lithosphere. So that will change the role of, the consumption or the absorption of the greenhouse gases. And since this ozone, the destruction of the ozone is because of this man-made chemicals, the chlorine and chlorine compounds and the bromine compounds like that. So, and so that is why it has the impact, as I have already shown, because the carbon, it changes the carbon cycle, which I think we have to prevent. And for that one, I think this is ODS, the ozone depleting substances, has been really reduced with the effective role of this Montreal Protocol. And in the part of the climate change, I think the Kigali Agreement, I think, which happened in 2019, I think recently it happened. So I think definitely this is going to play, along with the Montreal Protocol, a very effective role in preserving this ozone, so that we will have a very effective effective role in preserving the phytoplankton and other organisms which play a very effective role in the ocean dynamics in absorbing these greenhouse gases. So I think it is very important to have this the ozone in the upper stratosphere. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. Now I quickly go to the last part of the program. Now I would like to invite Dr. Arvind Ranade. He is a scientist working for astronomy and space science communication and popularization in Vigyan Prasar, DST, Government of India. He did his PhD in astronomical spectroscopy from IIT Pune. He was the coordinator of first National Science Film Festival and competition conducted by Vigyan Prasar. He was the coordinator of largest practical science lesson event of breaking Guinness Book of Record, World Record, by conducting chemistry practical by 2,000 students during India International Science Festival in 2015. Presently, he looks after the network of science clubs of the Vigyan Prasar program. He is the convener of national level talent search examination named Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan. He is also the key person for Ozone Day quiz program, which was organized by Ford Institute, SHAMA, IMD, IMS, and VBM. So let's welcome Dr. Ranade sir, and to express the result of our quiz.
Thank you, Dr. Swagata. This is a great privilege for Vigyan Prasar to be associated with the SAMA, that is South Asian Meteorological Association, along with the India Meteorological Department and Indian Meteorological Society. I still remember when our chairperson Tyagi ji and then secretary sir Someshwar Das sir, and of course the team that we all as a member of the SAMA first discussed about how to go for this World Ozone Day celebration, and the idea put forth by Tyagi ji to have a quiz competition. So certainly, as you said, like Vigyan Prasar has been part and parcel of various initiatives at national level, and then it also felt very happy to join this SAMA initiative along with the other organizing partner, and we started thinking about it. It's a good contribution done by our SAMA member of bringing out the quiz with about 50 questions with MCQ, that is multiple choice question format. And then we did a campaign for almost 5 days from 10th of September to 15th of September. And the quiz was closed yesterday. So as far as all the South Asian countries are concerned, except Myanmar, every country have participated in this quiz competition. And I'm happy to mention that all together from all the South Asian countries, we have reached exact number of about 23,617 students participated from class 8 to class 12 from all the South Asian countries, which includes India, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, and Myanmar. Of course, out of that, Vigyan Prasar, or the whole kind of an efforts by the kind of an organizing partners like Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan and NCRT, India performed quite well with the registration of nearly 22,000 plus. Then, of course, we have other partner, but after India, there is a good participation from Bangladesh, Nepal, and of course, Sri Lanka as well. There is a still participation from Afghanistan, Bhutan, Maldives, and of course, Pakistan as well. Now, today, I can say that as per the decision taken by the core committee of SAMA, that we decided to give a meritorious certificate to 10% of the students who register from that country. So today, out of all this, the total number of students who get the merit certificate is about 1,220 students. Those comes under the top 10% of the students from each country. And very soon, by 2 p.m., all these meritorious certificates will be available for download by all the students. However, we have given them an participation certificate as and when they appeared for the quiz, which consisted of 25 questions within 15 minutes. So no doubt the excellent work done by the SAMA members need to be appreciated and acknowledged at this point of time. Altogether, it gives a great feeling to be part of this organizing, member of this World Ozone Day. Of course, after India, except Myanmar, every country has some student to be called as an meritorious. And of course, we feel very proud to get associated with this. So I also would like to say thank you to Tyagi sir, Someshwar Das sir, and of course, all the esteemed members of SAMA Executive Committee, today's guest speaker, Sony sir, then of course our joint partner, Patnaik sir, who represent the India Meteorological Society, and of course from IMD, and of course along with the Madan Shrestaji, Raju ji, Mohandas sir, and of course yourself, Swagata ji. So with this, I feel very happy to say that today's initiative of this World Ozone Day celebration has come up in a very good concluding time, which gives them almost 23,000 students all across the South Asian countries. Though we spend very less time for the campaign for that matter, but in future years, we will do a great job. I feel it so. So thank you everyone to have a great association with this celebration. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to invite our convener, Professor Someshwar Das sir, for the concluding remarks and vote of thanks.
Thank you very much, Dr. Swagata. But I just think that Dr. Karmakar has just joined in. So can we give him just a few minutes to say something if he has joined?
Yeah, sure. So actually, being a partner of South Asian country, so my question was for him actually, What is the condition? Atmospheric ozone and its scope of research in Bangladesh.
Yeah, I am sorry, first to say, because of my internet connection was disordered, I think. So I think actually the about the research, before research, I think what Dr. Soni described all the chemistry and the conditions of, you know, atmospheric ozone already, he has explained very nice, I heard it. And about the scope of research, practically very less in our country. Nobody actually deals with this ozone. That is very, really difficult to say. But one or two studies are there, and that is with the ground level atmospheric, ozone. Especially one study was done in the city of Chittagong, and with the data from 2006 to 2007. And the authors already tried to show the seasonal variation and also the diurnal variation. And they mentioned that below 20 degree, the ozone remains stable and stable at night, but above 20 degree, I think the 30 degree, above 30 degree, the ozone already amount lower down. So this is the condition, one study is there, but there are no other study, but in our country, actually, I think we should take a lot of research work. I think Mohan is here. Also, there are some other meteorologists in Bangladesh Meteorological Department, I think, because in this respect, practically, we did not think about it. Because our, you know, Dr. Dash also knows that our research is very new, practically. So we are very much limited to the research of meteorological conditions in Bangladesh and adjoining area. Now, I think we should start another area, that is ozone. What is the condition of ozone in our country, and what is how it is varying? And I'm happy to know that Sony already told that the whole already, you know, already filled up a little, and the ozone condition is increasing. That is very happy news, I think. But our not only in Bangladesh, but in the total South Asian countries, 8 or 9 countries, I think our study on ozone, it should be increased and activated. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now also we have a lot of wings in under the umbrella of SAMA, so we can continue the ozone study in all the member countries. So now I call Professor Somesh Das for the concluding remarks as a convener of the SAMA.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Swagata. It's my present duty to present the concluding remarks and the vote of thanks. You know, we are celebrating the Ozone Day today, but it has spanned for more than 5 days, from 10th of September to 16th of September. This is the first international activity of summer. The Ozone Day 2020, as you know, has been celebrated by 3 different ways. One, by circulating Ozone Day poster and educational materials to the students of the 9 South Asian countries, including Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Myanmar, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. Number two, by conducting Ozone Day online quiz competition for the students of class 8 to 12 of the member countries, about which Dr. Arvind Ranade has already spoken. And number three, by the webinar that we are conducting today on the theme of World Ozone Day 2020, followed by the panel discussion which we just had of experts from Nepal and Bangladesh. I feel very satisfied that in our first attempt of this kind, we have been able to create awareness about the importance of ozone among more than 23,000 students of the South Asian countries. And I think this is a great success. As has been mentioned earlier, well, I would not like to go to the breakups that which country has how many participants of the students, which, you know, details has already with Dr. Ranade. But this has happened despite the COVID-19 situation. I mean, that's a great thing. No, we are all facing the COVID-19 situation, But despite this, so overwhelming participation from the students of all the 9 countries has taken place. And I congratulate all the students who defeated the COVID-19 and participated in the quiz. The certificates of participation has already been given to all the students immediately after the quiz competition, as Dr. Ronald has said. And he has said the merit certificates will be given to the top 10% of the students who have scored the highest in each country. SAMA is planning many such activities in the coming future. For example, we shall organize quarterly webinars and capacity building workshops, an online mini conference in October, November 2021 on the monsoon 2020. We shall conduct education, outreach, and scientific activities. SAMA is going to constitute effective scientific committees for developing subject-specific research and application areas. Several subject-specific scientific subcommittees, for example, for satellite meteorology, for numerical weather prediction, radar meteorology, air pollution, climate change, etc., will be constituted for an overall development of the region. We are developing collaborations with RIMES and ECMOD and many such international organizations for the development of this region. Our mission, as you know, is application of meteorology and allied sciences for the socio-economic development of the region. Obviously, such tasks cannot be accomplished by one person. And we are fortunate to have the support and guidance of honorable members of the advisory committee of SAMA, most of whom are the former director generals of meteorological services of the South Asian countries, or very senior persons, scientists and academicians. I would like to thank ABM Professor Ajit Tyagi, former director general of India Meteorological Department, who is the main brain behind this formation of SAMA. Would like to express our gratitude for his constant guidance and motivation in all the activities of SAMA. I would like to thank today's speaker, Dr. V.K. Soni, Head Environmental Monitoring and Research Center, IMD, New Delhi, for delivering a wonderful talk on 35 years of ozone layer protection scientific perspectives. I would like to thank the two panelists, Dr. Madanlal Srestha, academician and former director general of Department of Hydrology and Meteorology, Nepal, and Dr. Samarendra Karmakar, chairman of National Oceanographic and Maritime Institute, and former director of Bangladesh Meteorological Department and the SAARC Meteorological Research Center, Dhaka, for sharing many useful information about the importance of the ozone. I would like to thank Dr. Swagat Paira, Assistant Professor, BIT, Mesra, Jaipur Campus, India, for moderating the panel discussion. I would like to thank Dr. Arvind Ranade of Vigyan Prasar, which is the Science Dissemination Office of India, and Mr. Rajkumar of Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan for their immense help and support in making this event very successful. I would like to thank the India Meteorological Department, Indian Meteorological Society, and Vigyan Prasar for partnering this program. This activity would not have been possible without the dedicated and active support of our executive support team of SAMA, consisting of members from Bangladesh, India, and Nepal. And in particular, I would like to thank Dr. Mohan Kumar Das, Dr. Fatima Akhtar from Bangladesh, Dr. Vinod Dawadi, and Dr. Indira Karel from Nepal, Professor P.V.S. Raju, Professor Lakshmi Kumar, and Dr. Swagat Paira of India. They have been working days and nights despite their busy works in their own offices for making this program very successful. I'm amazed to see that I think about 60 I think people have participated in this webinar from the 9 South Asian countries. And thanks to this electronic communication and video conferencing technology, which has made this possible. I thank you all for making this program a grand success. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Namaskar. Thank you all. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.